code, you see. I don't know the PIN number. It's not until I'm challenged that I get the idea.
Well, it never lets you down.
It has never let me down so far. I'm just delighted it shows up in the same night as me. But then again, maybe there's other guys like that. I'm sure painters are like that. People who paint pictures. I'm sure they don't say, I'm going to paint that with a little stroke there and a thing like that.
They just get themselves in a zone.
They get into where it happens and get on with it. Well, I hope there are other. I hope not on my own.
In recent years, I've noticed that you really like to sit with other men, usually in a cigar store somewhere.
A cigar store, yeah.
And you tell stories.
Yes. I love the cigar store and I love my friends. I love the company of men. I like the company of women and every bit as much. But there's a part of my life that I like to spend with men. And I like the way men talk to one another and think and women think they talk about sex all the time and they don't. You know, they talk about politics and sport and sex and whatever comes into the conversation and have a laugh. And I have the time of my life, and I love smoking cigars and passing the time. And I know it's bad for you, but I don't care. I don't care. They're bad for you in the way motorcycles can be bad for you or wonderful for you. You know, you take your pick. The choice is yours. And I can live with that. And I hate the attack on smoking by... And I understand it's bad for you, and I don't inhale smoke and all that. But for instance, in Vancouver, there's a place I used to go to, the Havana Room. Many a happy hour I spent in there with all my pals, smoking and laughing like a drain, and learning interesting things. Well, the local authorities have taken it upon themselves, and for our own good, to close us down. We can't smoke there anymore. You can buy a cigar there, but you can't smoke there anymore. As a matter of fact, you can't smoke anywhere indoors. And in Canada in the winter, that's you can't smoke for half the damn year. You freeze to death. But the same people in their wisdom have opened a room where heroin addicts can go and fix. You know? And so I was saying, well, what's next? A special lane for drunk drivers? what's wrong with me all of a sudden? That's all I want to say.
And another thing.
And another thing from the great index finger waver. How dare you? Why, if I was 20 years younger? Yeah.
Do you find that people get on their high horse a lot with you?
Nobody has a higher horse than me. Sometimes there isn't a horse high enough. I just... love my high horses.
You turn that into a great strength.
It's actually a great strength. And that's what I'm saying. It's not what you've got. It's what you do with what you've got. And it certainly isn't what you haven't got. And it's taken all my life for these things to dawn on me, just like getting it and not getting it. Because with getting it and not getting it is so good, because you can then put something aside. I don't get it. Next. Instead of saying, why don't I understand that? There is no why. There only is an is and an isn't. You know what I mean? And if people concentrated more on how and never mind why,
yes,
we'd be in such better shape. You know, now there was Sarah Palin, wanted to be vice president of America, which would make her the second most powerful person in the world. And if McCain, unfortunately, died, she would be the most powerful person in the world. This is a person who thinks the world is 4,000 years old. You know, because she's into why. Do a bit of how it happened, and the why will go out the window. You'll realise the why is bullshit, and take your invisible friends with you. It's crap. It's juju. It's although I love that. I was in a sweat lodge recently up in British Columbia, I told you, and it was great. But when I was there, I met these guys from the Nizga, the Indian tribe, and they took me in British Columbia, and they took me out to the sweat lodge. It's one of the greatest days of my life. I don't know why, I haven't a clue why, but it has changed me. It might even have hurt me a wee bit. I find myself close to tears a lot more than I used to be. It's the most astounding thing where they heat these lava rocks. You go, you gather them first with the Indian guy. And Indian's okay, incidentally.
Is it?
Yes. And so is Eskimo.
Uh-huh.
That's one of
we
my discoveries.
We don't have to say Native American or Inuit.
You don't need to say all that. It's much better to learn what tribe they come from.
Yes.
And call them that.
Yes.
But they're quite comfortable with Indian. Mm. And the Inuit are very comfortable with Eskimo. Yeah.
You're talking about the sweat lodge.
We go and gather the lava rocks. There's a whole pile of them when you get there. A big log fire built up. And they get white hot. And you get your gear off. There's a pit. About as deep as that puffy there, and we're sitting round it, and we get towel, because you sweat profusely, and I'm thinking, I can handle this. And the man's talking, you know, they speak with that old wisdom. Men have to be treated, the earth has to be treated in a certain fashion with deep respect. We are the gardeners, which I had thought for years, you know. I thought, my God, these people have been reading my mail. Then he's got a bucket and a branch, and he goes, psh, you know, this heat. I've never felt the likes of it in my life. And then they got the drum and started to sing, hey, 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 and I'm sweating. I thought, I'm in heaven. This is astounding. I love this. And it deeply moved me, you know, the whole exercise. They were so honest and gracious with me and generous. I got so close to them, you know.
Is there anything from that you feel would be appropriate to share with me now?
I was saying to them, you know, you're so grateful for everything. Everything you say, your gratitude for your world, for your mountains and your trees and your bears and the thing, and you're just so grateful. I said, and I find myself being ungrateful a lot of the time. I said, when I look at my life, you know, the way I live, the money I've earned, the lifestyle of my family, you know, my security. I said, and I think I'm ungrateful a lot of the time, you know, but I'm not consciously ungrateful, but saying I should have more than I have, certainly not. But I sometimes think I don't treat it with enough respect. I wouldn't even attempt to guess at what happened to me, but I know I'm a different guy. It's just, there's a different thing about me. There's a different aura about me. I feel different in my skin, and I'm not sure what it is. It'll take me a wee while to find it. But there's something has changed in me, and it changed that day.
You told your biographer a few years ago that you felt that you were only 4 years old.
Yes.
How old are you now?
Oh, my God.
What number just came into your head?
Six.
You grew 2 years in that sweat lodge.
Four and a half also came in. Aye, this is that wee boy inside me. You can poo-poo that stuff all you like, that inner child stuff. I am living proof that it's very powerful.
Well, it really spoke to you.
He loved it. He loved it in there, in that tent. You know?
He was with you in the tent?
Oh, without question, yeah. He's with me a lot, you know. I sometimes forget about him, and then he reminds me he's there. It's astonishing that for anybody who doesn't know, if you get to know the child that you were when you stop developing emotionally and try and be friendly with him. Funniest thing is, when I did this in Los Angeles,
In therapy,
I had to write a letter to myself as the wee guy. And I spoke about fishing. And I hadn't been fishing in years. And he wanted to go fishing. And now, you know, I love fishing. Yes,
and you fish all the time.
And it's a lovely part of my life that I love. So you can poo-poo it all you like, but I am living proof that it's a very viable entity, it's for which I'll be eternally grateful.